everybody, and welcome to the Epic Awesome Show. And here with us today is Lucien Dodge.
Hello. Thanks for having me on.
You're welcome. You're welcome. How are you doing today?
I'm doing very well. How are you doing?
I'm very, very, very good right now.
Fantastic.
All right, so let's get started with the first question here. How did you get started into voice acting?
Well, I trace it back to my interest in Japanese animation. I was given the box set of the Slayers anime series for, I think it was my 14th birthday. Mm-hmm. And from there, I began to watch more Japanese animated series, and I had the epiphany one day when watching a series which utilized the same voice cast as another series that was dubbed by that same company. I recognized the voices for these characters coming from another series, and I realized in that moment that there were people who did the voices for these characters. They're actually real people. It had never occurred to me before that. So I was fascinated, and I wanted to learn all I could about this world. Mm-hmm. and the people who did the voices for these shows that I was watching. And I had done acting in school plays before then, but this was a completely new genre of performance that, again, had never occurred to me. So I think around that same time, my dad gave me his 4-track recording deck with a microphone, a Shure SM58, and a pair of headphones. And I spent many hours up in the attic just recording my voice and experimenting and creating characters with my voice and improvising skits and recreating scenes and monologues from characters, my favorite characters that I was watching or playing, as it were. I remember the time I was playing Lunar, the Silver Star Story Complete. Mm-hmm. And I recall using the particular item in that game which allowed you to rewatch scenes, cutscenes from the game, and I would play them and then dub them over and then play them back and see how I did. And that all spun into just this passion for the craft of voiceover. Mm-hmm. I love the fact that you could create any kind of character with your voice. And it didn't matter what your physicality was. It didn't matter how old you were, your ethnicity, any of that. All that mattered was, you know, can you create this character in the person's imagination using your voice and painting that picture? So I found that very liberating and wonderful. And I decided upon, again, experimentation and research that this was what I wanted to do above anything else, any other kinds of acting. This was what I wanted to do, and only that. So I embarked on a journey to to make it my career, and some 13 years or so later, I think it's been, I'm just really grateful to be able to say that I that's what I do. That is my profession. That is how I bring home the bacon. So that's a little long-winded, but that is how I got into voice acting.
Nice. So, okay, for each and every character that you do, what is your process of getting into the character?
Well, I try and find not as much. I find the key points of information about the character, mm-hmm. which will help me. If there's a picture of the character that automatically gives me a lot to go on as far as physicality and age and how he's built and or just kind of attitude, I can glean a lot of that from just a picture. But also just a breakdown, as it's called, something that describes their vision, the writer's vision or creator's vision of what that character is, what they're like. I don't need to know every single piece of information. I don't need to know what kind of syrup they like to put on their pancakes or, you know, stuff like that. But again, things that will cue me into how old they are, what kind of personality they have, and then the writing itself, how they're written. Hopefully, if it's well written, I can get a lot of information just from how the character is written, the cadence that in which they speak. You know, do they speak with a very sort of formal tone and use very grandiose words that will cue me in, as opposed to someone who maybe is written with much more kind of modern slang or very simple array of vocabulary that will give me clues. I take all these clues and I sort of put them in this grand voiceover cooking pot, and I just kind of come up with something through my years of practice and just fooling around with different characters. I just sort of it's almost a mystical process in a way. Sometimes I don't even know what I'll come up with, but once I just start playing around and performing the character, it's almost like I go on autopilot. I don't even if the character works well, it's almost like they're just kind of, you know, they're channeling, they're using my body and my instincts to sort of live, and I'm just kind of, you know, watching from the sidelines, and I don't have to do very much at all. That's in an ideal situation. Mm-hmm. It just kind of all happens very effortlessly.
All right. So how did you feel when you got your first role as a pro VA?
Well, let's see. If I recall, I believe the first professional job I ever did was for an audio dramatist by the name of Tom Lopez, who our family had been very big fans of his The Adventures of Jack Flanders and even the Ruby series as well. Mm-hmm. Although, again, Jack Flanders was our audio drama serial that we followed very closely. And it was just, again, for the same reason why I fell in love with voice acting and why mm-hmm. I just loved voice acting, you know, the audio dramas, they just, without, again, it's all, we're painting a picture for you using just audio and through music and sound effects and voice, we just paint this very vivid world, which this gentleman was able to do so wonderfully. And you just, you know, anyone who, you know, you can have five people just listening to the same audio drama, and everyone will have a different picture, I know, idea in their mind's eye of exactly how, you know, the characters look and what everything, how they visualize everything, because it's tapping into their imagination. And it's using all of these, again, these cues, audio cues in this case, to ignite in your mind something, and it's very personal for that reason, which is why I love the medium. So we are very big fans of it. Mm-hmm. We love these series. So I got to meet him through these series of workshops called the National Audio Theater Festivals, and I would say, I don't recall exactly how many years it was, but there came a point, as I recall, where he, I think he emailed me at some point and asked, hey, I got these short audio dramas I'm writing for like cell phones or whatever that people can just listen to on their cell phones. Would you like to be a voice? Would you like to do voices for them? And the obvious answer was yes, of course. Of course I would. So that was lovely getting to work with this man who we had just enjoyed his work so much over the years up until that point. And I mean, still do, but even just before I'd ever worked with him. So that was thrilling. I remember my parents obliged and drove me down to his studio in New York. I can't even remember exactly where in New York, but we took a little road trip and went there and got to visit his beautiful home. And I recorded for him a few different skits and characters. And that was that. And that was my first gig, as I recall.
Nice, nice. So what is your favorite type of character that you like to play?
Oh, I mean, as long as it's well written, I love, I mean, I'll do anything. And then again, that's why I love this this art form, is because I can play so many different kinds of characters. I often get cast as the young, plucky hero, or even more commonly, sort of the second string, you know, best buddy of the main character. I tend to get cast as those characters quite frequently, I guess, because, I don't know, probably because I'm especially adept at that kind of character. So I enjoy that. But then, you know, anytime I can flip that on its head and play the villain, or just totally off their rocker, crazy, insane, kooky, old man who's just kind of two screws loose of a bicycle pump. I don't even know what that means, but it's not going to be an expression because I said so. Just these wild characters that emerge, they stimulate different parts of my enjoyment of why I enjoy doing this. So if, you know, I get to do something a little strange, a little weird, I enjoy that. But the strafe stuff is fun too. I do like, there is something about the leading roles who have a very pure heart, and are pretty straightforward and simple to play. They may not have quite as many layers or fun little things to play with, like a villain or someone who's, again, a little strange or off, but there's something about that purity of heart, which, I enjoy tapping into. I guess it makes me feel good, you know? I just, makes me feel like a good person, and, so I enjoy playing those types of characters too.
Yeah. All right, so what has been your favorite character that you have been able to play?
Oh, that's always a tough one because, I mean, I enjoy different characters for different reasons. I don't know if I can categorize them as far as, you know, I don't know if I can rank them. Mm-hmm. Just within recent works I've done, I very much enjoyed playing Waver Velvet in the Fate Zero series, which is currently airing on Neon Alley, if you want to catch that. But I enjoyed that character because he was a lovely mix of, again, that sort of spirited youth and that kind of wide-eyed wonder and wanting to, as a young guy, wanting to prove himself to his peers. And within the scope of this series, he and this other character who, cause he's a mage, and he summons, and one of the plot points of the series is, all of these different mages can summon a servant, a very powerful warrior, and his servant is very different from him in that he's kind of this very frail, kind of unsure of himself, lad, and his familiar is this boasting, grand, macho, king who is just very forward and has a very strong personality. And so their personalities clash, certainly in the beginning. And watching him sort of interact with this other character, and within the scope of the series, which is a rather dark, sometimes gritty series, Waver and Ryder sort of presents the comedic tone of the series. They're very funny. Mm-hmm. They're kind of like the Abbott and Costello in a series, which is pretty serious, but they're sort of the light, again, the comedic relief. So I liked playing those comedic moments. I liked finding his I liked following his journey in finding his place and sort of discovering who he was and what was important to him and how he approached this whole Holy Grail war and how it changes him, and he develops these layers and grows as a character, which again I think is a testament to the writing, which mm-hmm. which is why I say I think if a character is well developed and written, I enjoy whatever that character may be.
Yeah.
So that is a favorite that I can name.
Alrighty.
Dust from Dust and Elysian Tail, which was an indie game that I had the great fortune of starring in, was a fantastic project to work on. The story of the game itself and how it came to be is just a fantastic one. And one, I'll only give the highlights, the cliff notes, if you will.
Okay.
I mean, you can find the full story, but basically it was one guy who made this whole game, and it's a beautifully crafted game. He did all the art and animation himself, and it's a beautiful, again, beautifully animated game, and the character, again, I got to follow him on his journey, and until its end, and it was just a really rewarding project to work on, just because of all of the effort from all around, the creator, the voice director, Devin Mack, and all of the other cast members. Mm-hmm. I was just very proud to be involved in that project.
Yeah. So talking a little bit about Dust and Elysium Tail.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever think it was going to become as popular as it has?
I don't know if... I mean, I certainly felt, based on the production values and the amount of love that you could just tell from looking at it, it was just created with, I knew it had to, that it was going to get some response.
Yeah.
I don't know, and in some ways, I still don't really know exactly how, how much of an impact, how widely... received, just how many people have played it. I still don't really know.
Yeah.
But it's been really heartwarming to see the people who I've seen come out and express, in just to me even, appreciation for the game and how much they enjoyed it. That's always really great.
Yes.
To see.
Yes, I do have to admit, though, that game, I had the actual pleasure of playing that game on Steam, and it is probably one of the best games I think I've ever played.
It's
really good.
I have to say, and I played it myself, and
yeah.
I think even if I wasn't involved in any way,
mm-hmm.
I would have enjoyed it just as much. Like, it really was just a really well-made game, I mm-hmm. thought, and fun. And captured my imagination, and it was just very enjoyable,
yep.
regardless of of my own involvement. In fact, I in a way, tried to tune myself out, and because they're, you know, as an actor, you're always sort of going to be critical or skeptical or nervous of how your own involvement in something like that is going to play out, and you just hope that you don't stink it up too much. So, in a way, it was surreal. It didn't feel like, for the longest time, like I was actually in the game.
Yeah.
It felt like it was someone else. So, it was just very, very surreal.
All right. So, I've got a couple of, like, random questions for you right now. Mm-hmm. And, all right, so if you could meet anyone from history, who would it be and why?
Oh, I mean, I don't mean to be boring, but I mean, within my own craft, I suppose meeting Dawes Butler or Mel Blanc, who are two of the pioneers of our industry, just genius voiceover talents, and created so many of the beloved animated characters that we know, and still are around today. I think it would be great to have met either one. Although, if I had to choose, I think I would probably prefer Dawes, because in all honesty, from what I have read and heard, Mel, not that he was, I think, evil or bad person, but I think I've heard he had his, you know, certainly had his ego, as well deserved, I suppose. Yeah. He was, you know, again, a brilliant character actor. But I think on a sheer human level, personality level, I've only heard wonderful things about Dawes Butler. Mm-hmm. And he certainly had a very giving approach. He taught many other voice actors, aspiring voice actors, one of which actually ended up being my mentor, Corey Burton.
Oh.
He studied with Dawes, and just all accounts, he was a wonderful person, very generous. And yeah, so I'll go with Dawes. Butler.
All right. So, what is your favorite movie of all time?
Again, this changes depending on what I saw at the time or what was fresh in my mind. Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind has been a favorite of mine for a while. I haven't seen it lately. I probably should. I should revisit. Actually, another. I'll say, Spirited Away is one of. I don't know. Again, it's hard to give favorites, but I will say, Spirited Away is one of those films that we actually, me and my girlfriend did watch that pretty recently, and that is one that I keep coming back to. And I remember when I first saw it in theaters, it was just blown away. And is my favorite Miyazaki film by far. I think before that it was Princess Mononoke, but I think definitely Spirited Away.
I
watched several. I think I watched a couple of times in the theaters, which I don't do really. I hardly watch movies in the theaters these days, but I remember at the time Spirited Away was one that I saw at least twice. So I'll go with Spirited Away.
All right. Now you had the opportunity to be able to do a character in Sword Art Online. Can you tell us a little bit about your character?
Well, as I recall, again, it was a brief role.
Mm-hmm.
I won't say why, although if you watch the series, you can probably guess. But as I recall, he was a very, again, he was one of those kind of pure-hearted, rather straightforward characters. He wanted to do well and protect his guild, and was just a general good guy, you know?
Yeah.
Trying to do the right thing. And yeah, I can't really say much else without giving it away.
Yeah.
But he has some difficulties near the end.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, somewhat sad, somewhat heartbreaking. But yeah, it was rather brief.
All right. So do you have any advice for anyone wanting to get into voice acting but just don't know how?
Well, since we have now the lovely access of what am I trying to say? We have the internet. You know, there is a lot of information you can find. Various sources. There are books you can purchase. I know was it Voice Over Voice Actor by Yuri Lowenthal and Tara Platt has gotten a lot of peer review and support from other voice actors who are working in the industry. You can go. He doesn't, unfortunately, he's I would say in a bit of a hiatus at the moment. But if you go to Corey Burton's message board, which he has on his website, and it's actually how I found him and discovered who he was. There is just pages and pages of threads, which a few of us regular forum members have asked him over the years about the craft of voice acting, and he generously donated his time to answer these questions, being a very busy voice actor himself. Yeah, I don't know. I'd say you gotta just go and do it. And by that, I don't mean, you know, you have to do it professionally. I just mean do what I did. You know, you can find material and recreate it and perform it yourself, record yourself, go to the various voice acting forums which are dedicated to voice acting, Voice Acting Alliance, Voice Acting Club. I'm sure there are other ones, but those are two they're off the top of my head. And just start doing it. Start if that is what you want to do, and you know if it is something that you want to do as a career, you know, if it's something you just would like to dabble in and play around with and just to have fun, then by all, you know, just whatever pleases you. You can take it however far you want. You can engage in amateur projects or get together with a friend and put together a self-made audio play. All of that is great. But if it is something that you want to do as a career for a living, you really have to dedicate yourself, your whole being and life to it, and find classes. Again, depending on your location, that is easier or more difficult to find classes within the respective field of voiceover, and there are several. It's not just anime. There's American cartoons, there are commercials, there's audiobooks, there's narration for documentaries, there's ADR and voice matching, there's promos, all different types of voice acting. Find what appeals to you, what you are passionate about, and seek out the people and the types of work which live in those in that genre of voiceover, and study it. Study it, practice it, study, practice, do it. Again, just learn all you can. Become a sponge. Soak up as much information as you can. And over many years, because it will take years, this is not something that happens quickly. I started practicing. I knew I wanted to do this 13 years ago. I am just starting to be able to say, again, within the beginning of this year, that, you know, that I make a living from doing it. Understand, you will not make a living at first. But if this is what you want to do, and nothing will stop you, you're willing to put up with the years of, you know, very scarce crumbs that may come your way, and just banging your head against the wall trying to break in, then over time, through dedication and hard work, you'll do it. But that is what is required, nothing less. You really do have to work very hard in order for all of that to take place and happen for you.
All right. I have one final question for you right now, and that is, are you currently working on any projects that you can tell us about?
I'm going through it, because as I'm sure you know, because you've interviewed other voice actors as well, there are the projects which we'd love to talk about, but haven't been announced yet, and we are barred from speaking about. So I'm going through the recent stuff that I've worked on, and that pretty much applies the old NDA. current projects. Well, I'll say, as far as what's currently airing now, on just Neon Alley alone, you can hear me as Takumu Mayuzumi on Excel World. You can hear me as Waver Velvet in Fate Zero. You can hear me as Adolf K. Weissman and Tatara Totsuka in K. And yeah, just recently on Toonami in Sword Art. I think that's all I can talk about, unfortunately. At least that is coming to mind. Because everything else that I recall. If you're in the UK, you can hear me on a live action Disney series which was brought over from Argentina, called Violetta, and I play one of the main characters, Thomas, in that. It's for younger, let's say, young teens, I guess, kind of that demographic. I'm not sure what else I can say. I think everything else worked on too recently in order to say. Well, there's a Danganronpa, I think I pronounced that right, is a video game which I was given permission to talk about immediately after I recorded for it. I don't remember, I think maybe early next year is when that's coming out for PSP, or is it the Vita? I don't know. You can find it. But I play Hifumi Yamada in that. And so that's something you can, I guess, it comes out a little later.
Yeah.
not too, you know, so yeah, but you'll have that to look forward to. That's something that I did pretty recently that I can talk about.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right. So thank you again for being on the show.
Well, thank you. Pleasure to just babble on about this craft, which I so adore.
Mm-hmm. Yep. All right. So that's it for this episode of the Epic Awesome Show. This has been Zane and Lucien Dodge. I'll see you guys next time on the Epic Awesome Show. See you guys later.